Shalom. This week we are reading Parashat Mishpatim, meaning ordinances. It's the sixth Torah portion of Sefer Shemot, the book of Exodus. The majority of this portion gives over many dinim, laws, the majority of which are civil laws, laws that govern a healthy society with a focus on the relationship between man and his fellow man and society as a whole. You know, many times over the years, this Torah portion of Mishpatim is read on the Shabbat nearest to Rosh Chodesh Adar, the beginning of the new month of Adar, as it is this year. And therefore, this Sabbath is also the first of the four special Sabbaths that precede Passover, called the four Parshiot. The four Parshiot, the Sabbaths which feature a special added Torah reading, were instituted by our sages. The source is the Mishnah, Tractate Megillah. On these Sabbaths, the four Shabbatot during the month of Adar, which precedes the month of Nisan, besides the regularly scheduled Torah reading, we read an additional Torah reading. These fourth Sabbaths themselves are called by special names. They are known in order as Shabbat Shkalim, Parshat Zachor, Parshat Para, and Parshat HaChodesh. Shabbat Shkalim, this week, always occurs on the Sabbath before Rosh Chodesh Adar, the new moon of Adar, or if the Sabbath falls on Rosh Chodesh Adar itself. The Sabbath takes its name from the subject of the additional Torah reading, the obligation of every Jew to bring a half shekel contribution to the temple from which the communal offerings are purchased. So for the additional Torah reading of Shkalim, we will this week be reading the first seven verses of Parshat Kitisa, found a little further on in the book of Exodus, in Exodus chapter 30, verses 11 to 17, which chronologically in our weekly cycle we'll be reaching in another few weeks. The background of this special reading, Shabbat Shkalim, is the Mishnah, which teaches us that on Rosh Chodesh Adar, the beginning of the new month of Adar, an announcement is made in temple times concerning the Shkalim, is the expression. It was publicly announced that all of Israel should come forth to bring the half shekel tax in which we are commanded as outlined in these verses in Parshat Kitisa. These funds were used by the temple treasurers to purchase the daily communal tamid offerings which are brought to the Holy Temple on behalf of all of Israel. But as we shall see later, there is a deeper reason for these half shekels as well. So back to our portion this week, Mishpatim. What's going on here is a continuation of the Sinai revelation. The nation of Israel is still standing at Mount Sinai, and these words are being spoken to them directly by God. In fact, the first verse of our portion begins with the words, "And these are the Mishpatim, the ordinances that you shall place before them." The letter Vav, meaning and these are the ordinances, goes out of its way to teach us that these things that are being enumerated in our Parsha are a continuation of the last Parsha, that just as the Ten Commandments and everything else that was said by God Himself was said by God Himself, so too, these things were uttered at Mount Sinai. This itself is a highly significant teaching. What we experienced in last week's Parshat Yitro, the indescribable spiritual high of the giving of the Torah, the revelation of the inimitable oneness of Hashem so clear as the heavens opened, the clear perception this week, suddenly, as they are still there at Sinai, so much of our Torah portion is very much of this physical and even mundane world. So many of these commandments relate to man's relationship not with God, but with his fellow man. So, ve'ele ha-mishpatim, and these are the ordinances. Everything is from Sinai, directly from God. Just as actually in the Ten Commandments themselves, the first four are about God, and the next six are about man. So, there are two types of mitzvot, of commandments. There are commandments that apply only between man and God. These are called in Hebrew, Bein Adam Lemakom. And there are commandments that are about man and his fellow man, called Bein Adam Lechavero. So here we are at Mount Sinai, and now Hashem gives over to Moshe a fairly long list of commandments and dinim, laws, that the newly formed nation of Israel will be responsible for. Most of them, classic examples of Hebrew law, touch upon legal aspects of man's relationship with his neighbor towards a just and stable society. Among the laws specified here, the Hebrew servant and bondswoman, prohibitions against and restitution for murder, manslaughter, and physical injury, laws of damages that are caused by a man's possessions or property, restitution for stealing, responsibility of being a custodian over another's property, compensation for seduction, a commandment to be sensitive to the helpless and abandoned, a commandment to extend free loans, prohibitions against perverting justice, against bearing false witness and taking bribes, and the mitzvah of returning lost property. There are also mitzvot, commandments between man and God presented here, such as the commandment concerning the firstborn of a clean animal, separation of milk and meat, the commandments of Shabbat, the sabbatical year, and the pilgrimage festivals, as well as some guidelines regarding entering the land, ultimately, and assurance of divine aid. In summary, after Moses gives over all these commandments to the people, at the end of the parsha, a covenant is made between Hashem and the nation. And there, at the foot of Mount Sinai, Moshe builds an altar, and together with Aaron and the elders, brings offerings. Afterwards, Moshe ascends to Mount Sinai to receive the Luchot HaBrit, the tablets of the law, and he remains there for 40 days and 40 nights, while God teaches him the details and practical applications of all the commandments. The teachings that God gave over to Moses during this period, explaining to him every detail of the entire Torah, form the basis for that part of the Torah known as the oral tradition. Now, every one of these commandments that are given in this week's Torah portion needs to be studied in great detail. There is vast richness of understanding here. Most importantly, there's a program. God took a people out of Egypt, presented them with his way for life, and is preparing to bring them into his land, where he instructs them to form his model society, to be an example to the world. And this gets back to why the Sinai revelation was expressed by God, according to the rabbis, in 70 languages, because ultimately, though Israel accepted the Torah, ultimately Israel is just to serve as an example. The program is for the entire world. But for now, I want to focus on one very deep lesson here for everybody. Last week, we saw that Israel accepted upon herself the responsibility of the Torah and the commandments. We know that while this is indeed an awesome responsibility, Hashem wanted to merit Israel, and so he gave them the Torah and the mitzvot. But practically speaking, how do I observe all of the commandments? How do we observe all of the commandments? How could each Jew keep all the mitzvot? After all, some of them apply only to certain people and under certain circumstances. Some commandments, for example, are only for Kohanim and Levim, etc. And some, not everyone has the opportunity in a lifetime to fulfill. This is why there exists a custom that some Jews are careful to observe. Two things. First thing in the morning, before the morning prayers, we declare out loud, "I hereby accept upon myself the commandment to love my neighbor as myself." And second thing, before performing any of the Torah's commandments, there's a little prayer formula which we recite, which states, "I'm doing this in the name of all of Israel." Because when we love each other, body and soul, all 613 mitzvot are performed by all of Israel in each other's names, then it's considered by God that each one is keeping all the mitzvot. When the individual includes him or herself within the entire body of Israel, the commandment can be performed in perfection. And all the mitzvot are dependent on this. It's the main thing, the foundation. The way to perform God's will is through selfless love for each other, where each one's love for the other is as himself, literally. Thus the great Rabbi Akiva taught, "And you shall love your neighbor as yourself," which is a verse in Leviticus chapter 19 and verse 18, is a great principle of the Torah, he said, meaning it is the basis of the entire Torah. And as the sage Hillel taught, "What is hateful to you, don't do to your friend. All the rest is commentary. Go learn it." So open up your heart in the deepest way. So, of all things, why did Torah choose to begin this section of laws, Parshat Mishpatim, that were uttered at Sinai, with the law of a Hebrew servant, the Eved Ivri? The answer is because the attribute of mercy precedes and is the foundation of everything. It's the most important measure of a man. The laws pertaining to the Eved Ivri, the Hebrew servant, concern a man who sells himself into servitude as a solution to extreme poverty, or a thief who is sold into bondsmanship by the court in order to raise the funds that he needs to pay back his victims. But the relationship between the master and the servant is one that is governed by great compassion. Great mercy has to be shown to this individual, even if he is a convicted felon. As Maimonides explains, all of the commandments associated with the conduct of this person, the Hebrew slave, are aspects of great mercy. The master is commanded to care for this person as he would a member of his own family. This is precisely why the Torah begins these sections of these community-oriented laws with the Eved Ivri, the Hebrew servant. A master's relationship with such a person is an experiment, no, a laboratory in learning to acquire and internalize the attribute of compassion and kindness. Without rachmanut, the attribute of mercy, there's no hope whatsoever for any person to ever be a functioning member of society. But once an individual has truly developed this trait, it will be easy for him to refrain from committing the other sins that the Torah continues to warn about as the parsha continues, because a great deal of the ability to consciously avoid doing evil is dependent on the attribute of compassion. A Rahman, a merciful person, doesn't hit others, certainly not his parents. He doesn't bear false witness. He doesn't covet someone else's property. He won't refrain from returning a lost article and everything else that follows. What is hateful to you, don't do to someone else. This is the foundation of the entire Torah. The rest is merely commentary. Now enter the perfect confluence between Parshat Mishpatim and Shabbat Shkalim. Let's get back to Parshat Shkalim and the unique commandment that God gave Israel for each individual to bring an offering of exactly one half a shekel. The obvious question is, why only a half? Why not a whole shekel? Actually, the details of this mitzvah state that even a hard-pressed poor person must find the way to bring that half a shekel. And the wealthiest of men, maybe a socialite, he can't bring more than half a shekel. So open up your hearts in the very deepest way. The half shekel is because each of us, each person, is not complete without being connected to the other. Only by being together with the other can the individual ever hope to be whole. Thus he remembers to at least try to love his neighbor literally as himself. It's two halves of one body. The perfect and complete vessel is built through love and compassion. That's the Torah's message for Israel and for the whole world.